Well, there was quite a flurry of excitement here at Broadcasting House not long ago when Paul and Linda McCartney arrived in the building. They'd come to visit us on Woman's Hour, and it was Linda, as a matter of fact, who was the focus of attention, because she'd been making quite a name for herself with her photography. Her latest book, called Photographs, is a collection of some of the black and white pictures that she's taken over the last 20 years. And she has a touring exhibition of her work. It was in Liverpool not long ago, and it's moving on to Jarrow next month. I asked Linda, when we met, whether pictures had always interested her quite as much as words.
Yes, I've always been a dreamer, really, looking out the window in school. The teachers used to tell my parents I used to watch the butterflies instead of looking at my books. And I was in Arizona, which is the southwest of America, very beautiful place. And a friend of mine told me about a course at the Art Center on photography, and she insisted that I go there, and it was in the evening. And I only went twice, but it wasn't what I expected. The woman wasn't showing us how to take pictures. She talked more about the history of photography and showed us photographs by Cartier-Bresson, Steichen, and some really great photographers, and I absolutely was hooked on it from that time on.
What sort of a woman was she, the woman who inspired you like that?
She was a woman in a wheelchair, and her name was Hazel Archer, and she had a daughter, and she learned at a college called Black Mountain College, which a lot of painters in America went to. So she's very artsy and very intelligent, and a very nice, inspiring woman.
Where did you learn your technical skills, though? Because that's pretty important in photography.
I still don't have great technical skills. What she used to say was, take your camera and take a roll of film and then come back to the class and we'll criticize it. And I didn't have a camera, so I borrowed a friend's camera, and I went over to another friend's house and just took pictures of a horse I had and my daughter and the mountains. And I honestly did not know how to work it, but you soon learn, you know, you just figure out, well, you get the light and you press the button, you focus and you press the button. It's not that complicated, unless you're going to be a fashion sort of studio photographer, which I would never be.
You specialized quite early on, I think, in rock musicians.
Mm.
You had rather a lucky break in that direction, didn't you, by picking up an invitation that wasn't really meant for you?
Well, I was a receptionist at a fashion magazine, and I used to see all the invitations that came in, and I was never interested, but then there was one that invited one of the staff to outing with the Rolling Stones, sort of a press thing. So I sort of took the invitation, put it in my drawer, and went to the yacht, and there were millions of people there, millions of photographers. This was about 66, 65.
They were a very, very big group.
Very big in America then. And all the journalists went on the boat, and then all the photographers were about to get on, and then just one of the men said, right, you, and pointed to me. And I was the only photographer allowed on the boat, so therefore all the journalists needed pictures, and they came to me.
Were you nervous being the only photographer there?
Actually, not at all. It was really fun. Everybody was so friendly. You know, I didn't think of myself as a photographer. It was more, you know, go around the Hudson River kind of thing.
Can you remember any of the shots that you took on that trip?
Oh, most of them, yes. Especially Charlie Watts and Bill Wyman. I took some lovely pictures of them. I've never really published them, but Charlie Watts sat in a corner on the boat most of the time, didn't say much, you know, but he has a great face.
I've noticed that you rather enjoy taking photographs of people just sitting quietly, people who are normally rather loud people, or we think of them as being rather loud,
mm.
Rock musicians, for instance, in repose. That interests you.
Well, the truth is most musicians, artists, even people put on a front, and when you just are friends with them, I think the real person comes out. I know in my book there are pictures of Jim Morrison of the Doors, who, I mean, people wouldn't believe it was the same person that was supposedly did all these horrible things, you know, because he was a very gentle, very intelligent person.
Is that how you met Paul, through your photography?
Well, I was in England on an assignment, but I went down to see Georgie Fame and the Blue Flames at the Bag of Nails, which I don't think is still going, with some friends, and Paul was down there with some friends. So we met that way.
Were you on an assignment at all to photograph him?
Well, when I came over, I wanted to photograph the Beatles and Traffic. I don't know if you remember them, because I think Stevie Winwood is a fabulous singer. And I got to photograph both groups. And, well, I was working on a book called Rock and Other Four-Letter Words. And I was doing most of the photographs for that, so I went to Los Angeles and England. It was a big break for me, actually. It was great fun.
There's a very interesting picture of Paul in the new collection. He's sitting in a London Underground train in the tube. Now, that's interesting on lots of levels. The one that interests me is that I didn't know that Paul McCartney travelled on the tube.
Well, that one was taken when I first came to England. We used to travel a lot on buses and tubes. We still do, actually. And we were taking pictures of each other. He took some nice ones of me as well. But it's fun. I mean, people, if they don't know you're coming to a place, they don't expect you, and you can just be very ordinary.
Are the British reasonably good about not plucking at your sleeve and saying, aren't you Linda and Paul? Do they leave you alone?
Well, they're very friendly. I can't remember any bad incidences. People come up and they ask you for your autograph, or they sort of say, oh, is it really you? You know, I can't believe it, that kind of thing. Other than that, even in America, though, people are pretty friendly about it. You know, they don't go mad. I think if you're announced and they know you're coming, they go mad. But otherwise, hasn't been a problem so far.
There's a photograph in the collection, too, of the rock singer Janis Joplin, who died a long time ago. And I think it was taken before you were really professionally known. But it's a very interesting one, because she looks really sort of ill and sad and old and rather raddled. Was that what interested you about her face?
No, I met her in San Francisco before they'd ever come to the East Coast of America. And I actually liked her group very much, Big Brother and the Holding Company. I thought they were fabulous. And her face interests me. And she was from Texas, and a very hard woman, very insecure woman. And I enjoyed photographing her and the others. But I think when people get mixed up with heroin, their skin starts getting a bit rough, as they say. So that shows up in that photograph.
There's some lovely pictures of John Lennon and Yoko Ono, some ones of Yoko on her own. But the one I liked with John and Yoko is a very peaceful one, again, of them. They seem to be listening to something as you photograph them. Was that what they were doing?
Well, it was taken, the picture you're talking about was taken while the Beatles were recording the White Album. And I think John and Yoko were very, very close then. I think John felt so relaxed with Yoko. I know she was just sort of touching him, and they just seemed at peace, almost like they weren't in the room kind of thing. I took a lot of nice pictures of all of the Beatles then, because, I mean, I was there, you know, and I was relaxed, and they were pretty relaxed, so.
You must have an awful lot of valuable photographs. You were saying earlier you had some of the Rolling Stones that you'll perhaps never show, but will be valuable to you for your own personal reasons.
Oh, yes. I look through them a lot and I think, oh, I love that one. Just all millions of different people. Memories galore.
Your horse, Lucky Spot, is an interesting subject of one of the photographs. I think people who don't know what Appaloosa horses look like will be rather startled by his appearance, even though it's in black and white.
Well, they're Spanish originally, but they're American Indian ponies. And we were on tour with Wings, and I wanted to get a horse that was calm and relaxed rather than a thoroughbred or a very highly strung horse. And we were on tour, and we were living in Dallas and rehearsing in Fort Worth, Texas. And I saw this horse as Paul and I were driving to rehearsal. And, oh, it's a long story, but anyway, we drove off the turnpike, as they call them in America, and found this little farm, and the horse turned out to be an unbroken stallion. But his blood goes back to the Comanche Indian ponies. And this lovely old farmer didn't really want to sell him, but in the end he did, and we brought him back to England, and he has sired two sons. But the nice thing is they have a lovely temperament, and they have beautiful color, because they're not just a solid color. Every Appaloosa is a different color, and they have a British Appaloosa society now.
Don't they change color as they get older, these horses?
Every year they seem to change, especially when they're pure. A lot of people cross them with thoroughbreds or quarter horses, but the pure Appaloosa is amazing.
Are they very important to you, your horses? I mean, how many do you have at home?
Well, a few people have given us horses, and we have a retired racehorse, but we only have a few we can actually ride. We have three babies. One's three. We're just breaking her now. But we all ride, so it's nice.
Even so, they must take quite a lot of exercising. I mean, you must have to plan it all quite carefully.
Well, the ones we ride do need exercise, but we put them out in the field when we're not riding them, and we're all fairly good riders, so we say, look, no bucking today.
Do you manage to lead fairly ordinary lives just as a family at home? I can tell that children and animals and, of course, Paul are terribly important to you. Do you manage to shut out all the public attention as much as you can?
I find it quite easy to shut it out. I like the other as well, but I do like... I'm an ordinary person, you know, I'm not... I wasn't a showbiz person, I was a photographer, I'm just a person, you know, so I'm not... I haven't been brought up, I didn't start young in the public eye. So I like truth, you know, I like just being ordinary.
But sometimes it's much harder for ordinary people to stay ordinary if they've suddenly been thrust into a very unordinary world.
Well, I think I grew up with good values. I think that's a lot to do with it. I'm not necessarily a materialistic person. My values are more earthy things, you know, so I don't find it too hard. Hopefully I won't find it hard, you know. It's easy to say that now, but you don't know what the future will bring.
You're still a member, of course, of the highly successful group Wings, so every now and then you have to stop being an ordinary person, in inverted commas, and become part of a hugely successful rock band. Is the transition hard to make?
I find it quite easy because when we did tour, we took the kids with us. And once you know the show and you know what you're doing, it actually becomes easier than life itself. Because you go on, you know which harmonies you're going to do, you know what you're going to play. And it's fun. You know, I don't find it stress. If I did, I wouldn't do it.
Group Wings, and Linda's latest book, Photographs, is published in hardback. Her exhibition we were talking about earlier, her exhibition of photographs, will be at the Bead Gallery in Jarrow from February the 9th. In March, it moves to Aberdeen, and at the end of April, it will be down in Rye in Sussex.